start on this page, Santa Catalina Island Basic Facts, because it kind of helps me bridge into where you're going to be and why it's a little bit different than most other Boy Scout camps. Emerald Bay is located on the northwest end of Catalina Island. It is the furthest inhabited area of Catalina to the north or northwest. We commonly refer to it as the west end, but to be honest, it's the northwest end. We are facing the mainland, meaning our bay and the shoreline is facing the mainland, so it is protected from the backside of the island and all the swells and a lot of the wind that comes from the open Pacific Ocean. So you can rest assured that we don't have surfing waves or dangerous shore-breaking waves in camp that are going to keep anybody from doing merit badge programming or just peacefully enjoying themselves on the beach. We've got all kinds of cool wildlife. Because we're so rural and remote, there are eagles and eagle nests within 10 miles of our camp. We see those bald eagles, osprey, golden eagles, pretty much any bird that ever migrates through coastal California will end up at camp and Catalina. So it's an awesome place to do those birds, those nature merit badges, and for folks who might have an interest in that kind of stuff. There's a mention of our special request form right here on this first page because it's that important. We're going to talk about it probably two more times today, but the special request form is an online resource for almost any inquiry or need out of the ordinary. So things like dietary restrictions, transportation concerns, you have a member of your troop who needs electricity in the campsite for a medical reason or for some sort of extra special situation, we're always going to ask you to send in a special request form. It keeps a digital record, so it doesn't leave it up to Linnea and I in our email inboxes to make sure that you're taken care of. So that special request form, I will show you exactly where to find it here on the screen in a bit. Let's turn to the next page here of the map of Emerald Bay. Thanks to Linnea, this map actually makes sense. I struggled with it for years, and it seems to be cleaned up and organized very well. You'll see the program areas normally marked with buildings or cartoon icons that are relevant to that area. And then you'll see campsites and other areas in camp labeled by a tent or the appropriate image. Along the left side, you'll see in the packet you're looking at is the list of campsites on the top. That's just in case you're familiar with campsites and there's one that you need maybe to be close to a power source or because you like to be far away from the noisy other troops. You can check out those campsites and let us know via special request if there's one you'd prefer to be in. The cooler part of this map is the latter half on that left column. That shows you a list of all the merit badges that we offer under a title of where they are in camp. So, for example, if you look at handicraft about halfway down, the art, basketry, leatherwork, wood carving, and pottery merit badges are offered in that handicraft building that's labeled just to the right of those words. So use this map. Each scout would probably benefit from having it in camp, but at least each leader should to help guide the scouts throughout the week. Are there any specific questions based on this map or any of the stuff I brought up with that first intro to camp in Catalina?
Yeah, just one. You indicated that we could potentially request a specific campsite.
Yep.
Is there any place that lets us know how many scouts or how many tents you have available?
The general rule is that the larger campsites are the first two and the last four. The numbers actually will change week by week.
Okay.
But campsite 1 and 2 and campsites 18 through 20 are the largest six that we have. So if you have a big troop, those might be the ones you need to ask for. The rest are kind of just if you prefer to be in the, close to a bathroom or further or closer to the water, whichever your preference is. We can also answer that in an email if it's something you need leading up to it. All right. Excellent. I'm probably going to talk quite a bit about these next two pages because they're going to bring up a lot of information regarding packing and transportation and even some of the programs that we have. So we'll kind of stop on these and make sure you guys ask me if there's any particulars that you need clarified. The top is just kind of a description of what you're getting into. The optional equipment by troop, we, from a camp perspective, we like troop equipment to be minimal. And that's not because we don't have Scout Spirit and we don't want you guys to be able to express yourselves as a troop, but really it's solely based on the transportation. Unlike other camps, everything you bring has to be carried by you out of your car into a boat, out of the boat by someone else, and then to your campsite and the entire reverse situation on the other end. It's not easy. So we ask that you don't bring things like wooden spars to build entryways to your campsites or large flags and things like that. You can bring patrol flags, you can bring troop flags, but we do have plenty of American flags that we can give out to you. There is a flagpole with a pulley system in every campsite, so you can hoist a troop flag or an American flag up there if you'd like. So you won't necessarily need the big flagpole and all that mechanism that's going to be hard to travel with. First aid kit is definitely a necessary piece of troop equipment. We want troops to be prepared to perform those easy first aid things in camp. Splinters, cuts, we want leaders to be administering things like Advil or Benadryl if that's needed. So in those troop first aid kits, it's triage stuff from Ace Bandage to Advil. And one special thing that you may want to think about is an anti-nausea medication. We don't sell Dramamine or anything like that in camp. A lot of families will send their kid prepared for the way over, but not the way back. And unfortunately, we don't sell those over-the-counter medications. So that might be something you want to add. Games, songbooks, musical instruments, that is okay. But the broad rule I want to say about bringing equipment to camp is if the entire troop can't bring everything, including personal equipment, in one load, then you're going to have a lot of trouble and it might not work out. So personal bag, a large bag or backpack with a day pack is probably all each individual is going to want to bring. Maybe they can spare an extra hand to help with some of that troop gear, but don't get carried away with troop gear. We will check out a limited amount of spars and ropes from the Scoutcraft area to do camp gadgets for requirements or build a small entryway. We ask that you please don't bring those things. The achievement section and Scoutmaster needs on this sheet are like those less common items that you need for advancement and troop administration. So all the clothes and all that's pretty self-explanatory, but the advancement and Scoutmaster needs sections are important to check out. We do recommend that you bring pens and pencils and records to keep track of the troop. Some of our documents are in here, like the program planner and the adult resource form. It's not a requirement that you bring either of those, but the program planner is helpful for everyone that's involved. And the adult leaders resource form we'll talk about later, but it's totally voluntary. It's just for you guys to let us know if you have any special skills that you're willing to help us out with in camp. Some of the other ones that get common questions in that Scoutmaster need list. We've got padlock on there. That's because we have lockers in camp that have a power source inside. Those are intended for leaders, not scouts. We do have master locks for rent, but if you don't want to rent or, you know, give us a collateral $5 bill for that lock, then bring your own lock and we'll try to have each troop have one locker at the least. Those are meant for, you know, adult tablets or cell phones or things of value that you don't want to leave in your tent. Other ones on here. As far as other technology, leaders who have business to do outside of the scouting realm or have an administrative duty with the troop are definitely allowed and prompted to bring technology like a laptop or a tablet. We have Ethernet connections 24/7 for use by leaders or folks 18 and up. We also have Wi-Fi for sale, just started last year, and it's $10 to $15 per, you know, for a gig, and you can use it all week as long as it lasts, and it's only really works in the front of camp, and I would recommend that only for folks who need to do emails and texts for business outside of the scouts or keep in touch with parents at home. We do have that available to leaders only. We don't have a no cell phone rule in camp for scouts, although we ask that use is minimized and definitely is not, it's definitely not allowed in our program areas by any of the scouts. You can have your own policy if your troop doesn't support cell phone usage at campouts. We will support you in that policy, but we know in these changing times, some people need it for some reason sometimes. So we're not going to be punishing if we have use of those things outside of our program areas, but the teachers and instructors and lifeguards will ask scouts to put those away and not bring them back to the class session if they see them. Any other questions about any of the specifics in that Scoutmaster Needs section or Achievement section?
If there are, so the only place that you'll be able to email is basically in front of your campus where you have Wi-Fi.
Yeah, the front third of camp, though, maybe about 10 acres, maybe 6 acres is covered with Wi-Fi, and there's a building where you can plug in.
Cool.
There are places you can go to guarantee, like, a text message to send out, but you've got to plan ahead. You're not gonna be able to accept a phone call randomly, because there is not, the service is not very good.
Right.
Verizon is definitely the best, followed by T-Mobile and AT&T and Sprint and so on. Equipment provided by camp is a little bit cheeky from us. It's just us saying, please don't bring these things. We have these things for you. They're not going to fit on the boat. You're not going to want to carry them over your shoulder. We have bulletin boards and trash barrels and fire suppressant items in all the campsites, as well as brooms. Each bathroom has its own outdoor wash station for hand washing, and it is possible to do a camp gadget with a small amount of water once you're in camp, but don't bring equipment for that, please, just for the transportation situation. Bunks and mattresses are provided. We've got metal spring cots and 3-inch minimum mattresses inside each tent. There's 2 cots and mattresses inside each tent for those of you who maybe have not been to a traditional camp. Even though we provide that mattress and cot for you, we do recommend as leaders that you bring a small, lightweight, easy to carry sleeping pad. And that is because everyone's going to be participating in our war canoe program. Even if you aren't able to canoe for a health reason or because you don't pass the swim test, you'll have the option of hiking to the same location. You won't have to carry your gear. But all the boys are going to be sleeping on the sand. And we can't have every single scout in camp carry a personal pad, but we can certainly deal with every leader doing that. So for your own comfort, if you don't need it, don't bring it. But we do recommend that you bring a small lightweight pad for war canoe for your own comfort and to protect your sleeping bag if it's a very expensive sleeping bag or something like that.
For the war canoe, is for every troop, must there be an adult that sleeps overnight?
At least one, yes. In a perfect world, it'll be more like every adult. Some adults and youth will travel back and forth via the hiking trail if they have scuba obligations or other merit badge things to do, but I would say 2 leaders. We don't really have a designated minimum because we do, we assume that all our leaders and youth go on war canoe. That in a perfect world, everyone would go either hiking or canoe.
And sleeping overnight.
Sleeping there with the troop, yes. But as long as we have the right supervision ratio, we can certainly, in the moment, make a special circumstance. I'm not going to read all of these items on the personal packing list. We want you to share this with everybody. I am going to highlight sun protection. It's a huge, necessary part of this packing list. Not just sunscreen, but a hat and sunglasses. Protecting your eyes is just as important or more than protecting your skin. If somebody gets a sunburn on day 1 or 2, it's going to ruin their week. So please stress sun protection to everyone. Even if you check a forecast and it's going to be cooler than the mainland, which it will be, please imagine that it's going to be the hottest and most intense sun you've experienced, because we want everyone to protect themselves. Another very important thing on this list is some sort of water shoes. We do not recommend flip-flops, even though they are allowed. They are not going to amply protect your foot or give you a very easy time loading and unloading canoes on a pebbly beach or doing other merit badge program. We recommend water shoes, water socks, or Teva Chaco style sandals. And I would even recommend an old pair of Nikes above a pair of flip-flops, just because you want something that's gonna stay on your foot and protect your toes and the bottom of your foot from the rocky beach and potentially any other hazards that you may encounter. So water shoes are very important. Everything else here I think is self-explanatory. Someone asked about fishing tackle earlier. We do not have poles, bait, string, hooks. We don't have any of it, just because we can't keep a productive inventory for more than 3 days. So if somebody wants to fish, they can bring their pole and all their gear. It is permitted to travel on the boat, and the pier we have is considered public. So even without a license, people over the age of 16 can fish from our pier only. If you want to fish anywhere outside of the pier, anywhere outside of standing on the pier, then you've got to have a fishing license if you're over the age of 16, over the age of 15. Any other questions about specific packing stuff or anything I mentioned? You guys are too quiet.
Oh, I missed it. So each kid needs one bag with all their stuff in it.
That is definitely my recommendation. Okay. A day pack is totally cool. It's actually recommended as well.
To have their personal stuff with them.
Yeah, because you're going to put your big duffel in the boat and you're not going to necessarily have access to it. So, you know, put a snack and a sweatshirt in a day pack with your sunscreen. You'll also probably use that day pack on war canoe or on any other extracurricular troop activities you go on. And we'll get there later on. Wear an A uniform in whatever form your troop requires. For dinner, for colors and dinner in the evening every day. We do not require an A uniform. I call it A, that's old school, pardon me, it's field uniform. We do not require it for breakfast, although some troops do, and that is completely fine, but we do require that field or A uniform for evening colors and dinner. If your uniform consists of the perfect BSA uniform with greens and belt and socks and everything, we're totally in support of that. If you wear other pants with your shirt, just please make sure that your entire troop is uniform. That's what we ask. As long as you guys are all uniform as a troop, then we're not going to be nitpicking on any of those details. Although we do support the full BSA uniform and the national one. That's still excuse me. I'm going to get into Rugged E and Rugged C a little bit later, so I'm not gonna go into depth there. Is anyone here familiar with our rugged programs, Rugged E, C, and then all of the rugged scuba as well? Is anyone like, what the heck are you talking about? I've never heard this word. Cool. We are gonna talk about Rugged E and C in depth, and I am going to invite up Carter from Malibu Divers to talk about Rugged O in a little bit, pardon me. And he'll go through plenty of detail about any scuba question you have. I'll then go into Rugged E and C. For now, this is on the packing list because these bold emboldened items are incredibly important for anyone doing these programs. So just make sure you refer to that if you have any boys taking part in those programs. I'm not going to read the things to leave at home, although they may be entertaining. Go ahead and read through those. Everything that is there has been brought to camp and confiscated or dealt with. Please address those things with your troop however necessary. Use boy leadership. But again, I'm not going to read through them all. We have had some interesting experiences, though. The special instructions down below are important. We do need every individual who comes to camp to bring some semblance of a mess kit. You're not going to use this mess kit at our dining hall for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. We are going to provide you with tableware at the dining hall. But, as I mentioned, everyone is expected to go on our war canoe trip where you will need your own mess kit, so we're not giving you paper plates and things to throw away. That mess kit, if you're a minimalist, just needs to be a bowl and a spoon. If you want a full mess kit, that's fine. Just make sure it's not you know, going to get lost or fall off the side of your bag. But if you're just a traditional Boy Scout or leader doing merit badges and war canoe, then all you really need is a bowl and a utensil, maybe a spork or something like that. You're going to eat deli meat sandwiches for lunch and or a veggie option or something, and a stew for dinner. So you will need something that can hold a stew. The unit insurance, we have the majority of, a lot of you are probably from West LA, I imagine, so we've got that insurance covered. You don't have to worry about it. If you're from West LA, we are the ones that hold that insurance policy. If you're not from West LA, we may not have an insurance policy from you, and we ask that you provide that for us. It, again, is not as much of an issue as we accentuate here, because once we get one from a troop from your council, we don't need 15 others. So what I'm going to say is, you can disregard this. We will reach out to you if we need your additional insurance, because we have collected a lot of these already. Passenger manifest is important. It's a state law that any charter boat operating out of the ports has a list of every individual that's on the boat. There are strange questions there that may not make any sense to you, like, we need to know the age and race of the people on the boat. I don't want to go into detail about why, but that is for extreme situations on a boat. It unfortunately is one of the easiest way to identify individuals in an emergency situation. So please provide us with the manifest. It can have handwritten names on it. It can have handwritten information. As long as all the people who are getting on the boat, coming to camp, are on that list. So if you print it out in advance, that's okay, but cross off people who got sick that morning and didn't show up to camp, or add somebody who last minute took a spot of someone else. Write it in on the bottom. We do need that ship, that ship's manifest, to bring you into camp. Any other specifics on these pages? I'm going to move on.
The manifest, that's, we like to print it out at home and then bring it that day, fill it out and then bring it that day when we want to.
That's it. That's how it's intended. And we do offer that skeleton form on our website on that forms and packets page I'm going to show you. It is the page. It's got everything you need, and I'll show it to you before we finish this meeting. I think we're actually on a really good pace here. Our next page. Departure and arrival schedule is very uniform. It comes out of an effort to improve the timeline on our arrival and departure days at camp, and a little bit more flexibility and comfortability through this whole process. Our new check-in time on Sundays on your way to camp is 7:30 in the morning. I know if you've been to camp 2014 or before, that you've experienced check-in time being between 7 and 9 and not leaving until 11 or 12. That is not the case this year. It was not the case last year or the year before. We successfully loaded 95% of our participants between 7:30 and 8:30 in the morning. And they all checked in and departed within an hour of our 7:30 check-in time. Expect that to be the case. Please do not plan to be late, or you will very likely miss the boat. There are multiple boats, which makes this travel situation a lot easier on you guys. We're not going to have you sit outside of the bay like we used to and watch our staff throw your bags into a floating luggage barge. That is all a thing of the past. You'll load on a boat with your entire troop, you'll go directly to the camp pier, and you'll unload. It's much smoother and easier than it has been in the past. This will be the third year we've done it this way, but it's imperative that you come to to the dock at the 7:30 check-in time. Ooh, I'm getting little hearts on the Facebook. I love it. Excellent. I made that up. This is a this is something that I instated years ago, 2 years ago, with Camp Director John George, and I believe that it has been an improvement. But please plan on being there at 7:30. I described at our last meeting that the process of arriving and loading should be rather simple for you, although we know that moving parts with 20, 30, 50 kids is difficult. The way we expect it to happen on your end is to use some sort of mobile map system like Apple Maps or Google Maps, MapQuest, to get you to the USS Iowa, the battleship, USS Iowa, or Berth 87. That is the best address to give your drivers, because not only can they park there, but there's also a loading and unloading zone there. So if they're just dropping off, they can drop off without any traffic issues, because it's a completely enclosed loading and unloading zone. We've had issues of people not adhering to posted signs and getting tickets. Please do not leave your vehicle in a loading zone that has signage calling it a loading zone. We cannot protect you from the Los Angeles County Police Department. So we do recommend that you use the USS Iowa Berth 87 as your departure location, where all your cars should meet. There's a free hour in the parking lot for those cars who are just dropping off, so they can enter and park, and that would be even easier than using the loading zone. As long as they leave within an hour, it will be fee-free. If not, as printed here, without any association with us, the Parking Concepts, who runs that parking lot, charges $16 for a 24-hour period. It's not a very affordable parking option, although we believe it's the safest one in the area. If you know something that we don't know, go ahead and park your cars elsewhere. But you can still drop people off at the USS Iowa lot. I think that would be the easiest for your troop. That was a mouthful, but I've been on the phone with the police and fire department, and I want to make sure that we're not setting you guys up to be punished or be in a bad situation. I am going to change one of these bullet points on this page. I do not want to impose an arbitrary restriction on the size of the bag you bring. Because we're not using that luggage barge anymore, because you're unloading directly at camp, if you can carry a huge mummy bag with all of your stuff, that in fact is my number one recommendation of what you should do. If you have an internal or external frame backpack that can carry all of your stuff, I recommend that you do that. It's easier than it was in the past, and the more things you can carry on your body, in front or behind, the better off you're going to be to help with troop gear and things like that. One of the most important points about gear, because I'm talking about it, is to label every single item. Please label every single item that you bring to Emerald Bay with the troop number. Even better if it has the individual's name on it, but it has to have the troop number on it. If you guys have a camo neckerchief and you can mark every bag with that, that's cool too. But putting the troop number on the bag is necessary, because someone else is going to pick up your bag and bring it into camp. If it doesn't have your troop number on it, they're not going to know where to put it. We'll have signs as you enter camp for gear piles for every individual troop that's arriving that week. If you don't have the troop number on your bag, it's going to end up in a huge miscellaneous pile, and you're going to have to go dig it out. So, or it may not show up where and when it's supposed to. So it is very important to mark your bags. We recommend using duct tape and making a tag over one of the handles by taping the tape together and also to a handle, so you can write the troop number on it. That's the best way if you don't have patches or embroidery on the bag or something like that. You on in that description? I've talked about a couple of these already. Everybody who comes to camp needs to have the BSA medical form A, B, and C. This is adults and youth. This is even me. You have to have medical forms A, B, and C filled out by you and a doctor in order to take part in camp. If you don't have it or you don't bring it, you're not gonna, we're gonna send you home. So please make sure everybody has that. If you're doing any scuba, or it, no, excuse me, we're gonna talk about this later, but we recommend very highly that you fill out the PADI scuba medical as well, even if you're not doing scuba, just because we don't wanna break any dreams because of paperwork, and we'll get there again later. We also have some consent to full program forms that we'll be distributing via email, and so we will need you to bring those into camp as well when you come in. I mentioned... I just get a little excited. All it's right. In that bold paragraph on the required documents, page 9, but there is going to be more details. There are exceptions here that are written if you have certain issues, and I think it addresses most anything you could be concerned for. That special request form I mentioned is going to come up again, because if you have vegetarians, gluten-free people, or dairy-free people in your troop, please make sure to document that and communicate it to us. You can send us an email and we'll tell you to fill out a special request form, or you can fill out a special request form and then email us, and we'll make sure you filled out a special request form. But we want to take care of all those special needs. We think we're at the forefront of dietary flexibility as far as Boy Scout camps are concerned. We have a special staff member in the kitchen called a compliance manager who makes sure that items that can be allergy related are prepped in different areas. We have individually packed gluten-free products and so on and so forth. So if you communicate it to us, we are going to do our absolute best to take care of you in those situations.
We've got a quick question. Mm-hmm. We will assigned sea-based part C work, or do we need the other part for scuba?
We need specifically the PADI medical form. If you did an ABC BSA form at another camp and it has been within a year, it is accepted. But in order to do any type of scuba at camp, you've got to have the PADI medical form filled out before you come by a doctor. I'm going to breeze through this next one pretty quickly because it's really just a service to us. Because we know that there's hundreds of you, hundreds of leaders coming to camp who may have skills that can help us, we ask that if you're willing to share that skill and potentially help us in camp while you're there, to please fill out one of these adult leader resource forms. This is for those of you who are maybe merit badge counselors or have a trade that we may need help with on our facility that might have nothing to do with the boys that you bring to camp. Because we're so rural, we would appreciate any help if you're an electrician or a teacher or counselor. If you do anything that might be able to help us in our unique situation, fill this out so we can reach out to you while you're in camp. This is totally voluntary. I'm gonna introduce the Senior Patrol Leader training program that we offer. We have offered this program for over a decade, but we have made some changes to it this year to make it a little more exciting. The SPL training program is also completely optional. Although we had a great testament to the SPL program being a positive thing for a troop in our last meeting, a troop leader said that their troop even pays for the boys to go. They don't put that cost directly on the family because it's an extra leadership training program. They've rewarded youth with access to this program, or they've just highly recommended that scouts come and take part in it. Not only are you going to learn how to be an SPL at Emerald Bay, but you're also going to get patrol method leadership training from very experienced Emerald Bay staff members. And also, you're going to have the chance to do some pretty cool recreation on the island before your troop arrives, or when there's no other scouts in camp on that Saturday when our staff is off. The SPL staff is on and hosting those SPLs in training and recreation. Lastly, we added the opportunity to earn geocaching and or, we're still working on, communications merit badge as part of this program. We're working on the nuances to make sure that merit badges are earned and not given. Linnea and I are not positive that we can do everything that communications requires in camp, but we're going to try. So it will very likely be an additional option with the SPL program. But geocaching, we've already got a donor who's going to be giving us upwards of 10 GPS units so we can do some geocaching on the West End and, you know, better incorporate the awesome hikes around camp into our programming. You may have a question like, how is this kid going to get to camp Thursday before everyone else? And that is described on the transportation information there. We will have adult staff members meet those SPL candidates at the Catalina Express Terminal, which is not where the troops go on Sunday, to come out to camp via Catalina Express, hosted by our staff. That schedule is yet to be determined from Catalina Express, so we've just said that you'll be departing in the afternoon on the Thursday before your troops' arrival. It's very likely going to be between 1 and 3 in the afternoon from Catalina Express in San Pedro. But we will be in contact with those of you that sign up for that program before you have to arrive. Sea or rugged canoers. I'm gonna go a little bit quicker on this one because we only offer it for 3 to 4 weeks at the end of the summer, weeks 6, 7, 8, and 9. But it is an awesome experience for those individuals or patrols or troops who have long-term canoeing experience. Rugged Canoe will take, just like scuba, just like the week-long scuba programs, will disallow scouts from taking part in any merit badge program. It is literally the circumnavigation of Catalina Island in a war canoe. It's an awesome, I think awesome is the best word, experience, but it is not easy. For this, it's geared more for scouts 14 and older. Leaders are encouraged and welcome and encouraged on Rugged Canoe, but those leaders should be prepared for a physically challenging 5-day canoe trip. It is not easy. Again, sun protection is completely important, but it is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. If you have boys who are reluctant to go to camp because they don't need any more merit badges or they think they're too cool to hang with the young boys in the troop, put them in Rugged C or Rugged E, and they will have one of the most awesome weeks of their life. They truly are. We will challenge them. There is leadership training incorporated in all of these programs, and they'll earn a cool one-of-a-kind neckerchief that they can put on the wall or wear to unique events. They're just really cool opportunities. This will give you a more romantic description of the program if you want to read through that. Again, it's only in the latter half of the summer because of conditions. It is a serious trip. If you haven't done an overnight canoe trip with your troop, or you haven't gone to Northern Tier, we do not recommend this program. But if you've got older boys, an individual or a buddy pair, who are negative about the rest of the experience, this might be the right challenge for them. So look into this, email Linnea about program details, when it's offered, and what they can do with it. Rugged E, or, yeah, go ahead.
Are those programs included in the price of camp, or is there additional?
The only difference, perfect question, the only difference for Rugged E and C is that it costs the out-of-council scout rate for that particular week. So you won't get a leader discount, and you won't get an in-council discount. But Rugged E and C will cost the highest scout cost for the particular week that you're participating. Perfect question. So on average, it'll be about $600, $650 to do the program, depending on the week that you're there. Different from Rugged C, is offered every single week. We have about 5 to 35 participants in this program every week. We have incredibly experienced adult staff members running this. So leaders are allowed, but they are not necessary for this program. We have ample adult staffing to supervise the Rugged Explorers experience. If leaders are interested in going to be part of the crew, to be with their son or daughter for this program, that is totally cool. But again, they'll be paying the highest rate of camper for that week. They won't be getting the leader deal. Also, if they are not physically in a place to participate in a 40 plus mile bike trip and a half day 2,000 foot elevation gain hike, then they shouldn't go on the trip. And I say that out of experience. We do have a little physical test on Sunday, arrival day in camp, to make sure that the scouts and leaders signed up for these programs can make it through the program physically. In my experience, it is more of a mental challenge. Most anybody in scouting can do these things, but if there's hesitation or if there's ailments, we do not recommend that they attempt it. A little bit more detail about Rugged E. As I mentioned, there's a long bike trip and canoe trip, as well as hike. Those bike trips and canoe trips are overnighters out of camp. So those Rugged E scouts will be separated from their troop for the majority of the week. There is time that they can have with the troop in camp. There's minimal time, but they really will be in the patrol method doing Rugged E and cooking for themselves rather than eating in the dining hall every day, getting a unique leadership training opportunity with all that outdoor action. So we highly recommend this for those scouts who may have Eagle Scout or all the merit badges we offer, or those scouts who don't necessarily feel like they fit into the merit badge crowd in your troop. This is an awesome trip that's going to make them feel accomplished at the end of the week. Not to mention, the staff who we hire in this program are the cream of the crop. We let them leave camp without us and do all kinds of cool trips with your youth. So I'd highly recommend this trip for boys who are physically and mentally able, 14 and up, and don't need more merit badges.
Jumping on that, I just want to stress the importance of bringing your own water containers. We won't have water bottles to give to all the scouts, so make sure they come with 2 to 3 liters of water so they can bring it and fill it up on all of their excursions.
That's a great addition. And what I skipped over on the packing page for Rugged E and C, the fact that dry bags are highly recommended for Rugged E and completely necessary for Rugged C. And they also need a day pack for both of these events, as well as a water container and very, very ample sun protection.
Yeah. Do you sell sunscreen there?
We do. We have sunscreen and chapstick, but and that's a perfect question, which actually prompts me to go on my little sun rant. Sun protection at Emerald Bay is more than sunscreen. We're talking hats, sunglasses, and clothes when you can wear them. There's no reason to suntan at Emerald Bay. You're going to get those UV rays anyway. So people should wear t-shirts as much as possible. I wear a baseball cap every single day in camp, and I wear sunglasses most of the time to protect the baby blues. So please, sun protection is a huge thing. It can mess up somebody's week.
If you have fair skin when you're swimming,
yeah, a wind shirt, rash guard. We're not gonna. You're allowed to wear a rash guard in water activities at camp. It doesn't help your buoyancy. It's gonna just make you more comfortable from the wind and sun. That's totally cool to use in camp. It's also easier to pack. Part of the reason why we use a digital system for our merit badges instead of blue cards is to so we can better organize and keep records of what your boys are doing in camp. Once we open up this merit badge registration system on Double Knot on March 1st, the registrant or troop leader who has registered the troop already for this summer will have access to add individual scout and leader information, which is imperative because after you add their name and basic information, you will add their intended merit badge schedule for the week. And this merit badge schedule is live and editable by our staff during the week. If merit badges change, if unforeseen issues happen, we will edit this and it'll create a digital storage of what requirements the scout has done and what merit badges they have completed, so you can go home blue card free and still provide ample records to your local scout store and troop record system for Eagle Scout and badge distribution. Yeah. Okay,
so on blue cards, it says we don't have to bring any, and I'm familiar with the blue sheets at Whitsitt and Emerald Bay. But we had a couple of years ago, we had a case where a counselor came from another council and did communications merit badge. It was called a pop-up.
Right.
He only did blue cards.
Yeah.
So should we still take a few with us just in case?
You mean in camp?
Yeah.
We will have blank blue cards, mostly because the scuba merit badge will have manual blue cards, and sometimes we have situations like that. So there are blue cards available at our clerk's office in camp for one-off situations like that. That is a good question. While it's not easy in the front end, this digital merit badge program has proven to be incredibly successful for our camps. We have records that we store as far back as 11 years ago with merit badges earned or partial merit badges completed from your scouts. So in November, when you have a court of honor and you find a discrepancy that somehow slipped through the cracks in July, you can still email Linnea or the camping registrar or myself, and we can help correct those records and send you a blue sheet that represents what your boys earned. So it's a little tough on Friday in camp when we go through the records and Saturday morning, but I think in the end it does help the situation record keeping wise. Again, we will, so the way this works is at the end of the week, on Friday night, we'll give you a paper copy with each boy in camp with your troop listed on the blue sheet. Under the boy's name, it'll show the merit badges in session order, meaning the merit badges they took from morning till afternoon in chronological order. And if they completed it, it'll say the name of the merit badge. If they got a partial, it'll say all of the requirements that they did complete. That way, if you come home and have to finish canoeing merit badge on a lake here, you show that counselor the requirements that you did complete, and they will sign off a manual card that says complete after you do the rest. That is how it's intended to work. There is a time on Saturday morning, once you've looked over those printed sheets that we provide, where we will correct things in our digital system before you leave. Now, we won't send you home with that paper blue sheet that you can turn in to your store to get patches. We'll email that to you about a week after your trip to camp. And so you'll have those records that you can store digitally and hard copies week after you leave Emerald Bay. We will get more into this as we look through the program planner, so I'm going to switch to the next page. This is, I want to be very clear, these are recommendations to help you help the youth choose the programs and badges that they take part in. So by that, for example, it splits up all of our merit badges to level 1, 2, 3, and 4. The easiest way to break it down is that boys who have never been to camp before should focus on level 1 badges. Second year summer campers, level 2, and then so on and so forth till level 4. There are exceptions to this rule. We understand some of you will have 11-year-olds who have been competition rifle shooters for 4 years. It happens, and they are able to take the rifle shooting merit badge. This is our effort to make sure that the majority of the scouts who sign up and show up to classes pass those classes, so we don't have classes impacted with folks who can't pass them, disallowing others to sign into the class. So we ask that you use this sheet to more appropriately create a schedule for your scouts, although these are recommendations and exceptions are made. I will say that we've gone through great lengths to even out the amount of scouts and troops in camp each given week, very successfully in 2016 and 17, and we're continuing that plan this year. We don't anticipate any merit badge classes being closed because they're overpacked, but we want to provide a quality and consistent program. So if we think it's necessary, we may do that. And you can help us by appropriately assigning scouts to merit badges using this sheet. Any questions about that sheet specifically? Our next one is a merit badge prerequisite form. It's self-explanatory. There are three badges that we know there are prerequisites for that you cannot do in camp. Energy merit badge, camping merit badge, and scuba merit badge. There will very likely be an additional additional requirement added to the camping merit badge prerequisite because we may, in our efforts to make sure that we are not giving merit badges, but letting scouts earn merit badges, we might add a requirement to the camping merit badge that they cannot necessarily finish in camp. And that would be planning and cooking 3 meals on a camp out, which we imagine most boys who take camping merit badge will be able to do in advance with their troops, or already have. In the past, we've provided that opportunity on War Canoe, although it may not be sufficient for the requirement. So we may be adding that requirement onto the prerequisite form. That will be finalized in the final, we meant for this to be the final version, but in the final version that we put out on March 1st, that may be the only relevant, you know, non-typo update to this paperwork that you're seeing. The next page, again, is not prerequisites, but recommendations. This is just explaining that in our shooting sports program, we want older and potentially more experienced or stronger scouts to sign up to make sure that their pass rate is somewhere close to 100%. We have written tests associated with our shooting sports merit badges. And I will say, yes, I am aware that a written test is not a requirement for rifle shooting, shotgun, or archery, yet there is a requirement that states a sufficient understanding of technical and safety standards for firearms. The way we test that knowledge is through a written test. If a boy is unable to pass that test, we will provide another way for them to display their understanding if that is the case. They can retake this test, they can verbally take this test with a staff member. As long as they're willing to sacrifice a little extra time, we will make sure that folks earn these badges by the book. But it's just a way that we've been able to test people's understanding of those technical and safety skills. Pardon me, I know this stuff is a little dry. These next two forms are going to be incredibly useful and important to you, especially this one that I have on the board now. It is our merit badge schedule worksheet. Our intention is that you distribute this sheet to all of the boys going to camp at a meeting before you go to camp. Actually, sooner, the sooner the better. This shows all of the sessions that we offer throughout each day at camp across the top, and it shows all the merit badges and BSA programs that we offer across the left column. All of the white boxes represent available classes that people can sign up for. Our recommendation is you distribute these at a troop meeting soon. A scout writes their name and information on the top, and they fill out the form so you or whoever has been registering the troop can input that information into DoubleMill. Starting on March 1st, there will actually be a new button that didn't exist before that allows you to add the scout's personal information, which includes their intended merit badge schedule. Yeah.
Is this the official merit badge sheet?
This is the form for 2018. We have made adjustments, and it is up to date. So you can go with this at your next troop meeting if you'd like. It's not imperative that you sign up for merit badges on March 1st. You don't even have to do it in the month of March. But if May 1st comes around and you haven't done it, you are behind the curve. So we recommend March and April. These discussions happen at troop meetings, and you start to plan out each boy's merit badge schedule so you can input it into the digital system. One point I want to make about this while you're looking at it, you'll notice that some of these programs say BSA instead of MB for merit badge. All of those programs that say BSA, like BSA stand-up paddleboarding, BSA aquarist and oceanographer, are all available to adults as well as scouts. So you adults can sign yourself up for these in advance, but we understand that your time is going to have to be flexible in camp. You can certainly walk into any of these programs labeled BSA. Those are all awards represented by patches that we distribute in camp that adults and youth can participate in. Some of them, you'll see on the far right, have pretty serious recommendations and prerequisites. Some of them are very difficult. The oceanography merit badge and BSA oceanographer require a certain amount of literacy and study habit. They're scientific, so make sure that you use this form and the sheet I showed you earlier with the merit badge levels to properly set up a merit badge schedule for each kid. Does anyone have any specific questions on this stuff? Again, like he asked, this is our 2018 merit badge schedule.
Yeah, but what is the time commitment for BSA lifeguard? I know that sometimes it's taking a whole week.
Yeah, so it's a minimum of 2 merit badge sessions, although it's also going to require free time taken up acting as a lifeguard in camp and serving your troop in camp to finish some of that time requirement. So it's session A and session 1. Granted, session A is also a half hour longer than any of the normal merit badge sessions, I believe, or 15 minutes longer, which actually amounts to quite a bit. So you'll be there session A before breakfast, session 1 after breakfast, and it'll take a fair amount of your free time to earn BSA lifeguard. A lot of folks that take it don't earn it the first time around because of the time requirements, but we do have a very highly trained staff who sufficiently teach those skills. It's a very elaborate program.
I just want to jump in really quickly. There is one edit to this form. If you look at the first year rank advancement, there's a space splitting those two available boxes. That's actually a mistake. That is a first and second session class. So anybody enrolled in first year rank advancement will be in first and second session.
And that's perfect. And to add on to that, we recommend that program for new scouts or tenderfoot scouts only, because there are going to be an equal amount of tenderfoot second class and first class requirements covered in that session. If there are boys who are second class already and still want to do some advancement work, The scout craft area is open during sixth session to provide drop-in advancement opportunities. So those first and second year boys, if they're not almost first class, they should take that two-session first year advancement. It tends to be a big class and they get a lot done. But anyone who is almost first class, we recommend they take merit badges and maybe drop in to do some of those camping advancement style requirements. Great. We, at Emerald Bay, we make a big focus on offering things that most troops can't get their hands on or get their scouts into here on the mainland. So we are not a merit badge mill camp. The average scout at Emerald Bay earns 3.7 merit badges. So those families that want their boys to leave with 5 or 6 merit badges may be slightly disappointed at the end of their week at camp. But let me tell you, the youth, the scout will not be disappointed with the amount of recreation and scout experience that they acquire out at Emerald Bay. We want a perfect balance of merit badge classes, if you will, and outdoor recreation. I just want to clarify that because when you take in the next page and all these merit badges we offer, it's nearly impossible to do everything. And that's because you're meant to go out and have fun and not just sit and earn merit badges all day at camp. Yes?
Does advanced small boat sink?
Perfect question. This stems from our attempt to have a more valuable and advanced sailing program in camp. We started this effort last year. We have two special 22-foot keel boats made by Beneteau, donated to Camp Emerald Bay to teach advanced sailing to adults and scouts. If scouts already have the small boat sailing merit badge and all they want to do is sail and they don't care about earning merit badges, then that is the class for them. It'll give them an opportunity to sharpen their sailing skills and get more time on the water. We don't recommend that anyone take both small boat sailing and the advanced sailing. That would be very redundant because they will have a session together. If you notice, session 3 will be an instruction and gear-related situation, and then session 4 is small boat sailing, and session 5 is advanced sailing. The big sacrifice to be in advanced sailing is that those sailors will not be able to participate in the free time activities with their troop at 5th session. That's the session where you go snorkeling or mountain biking or just playing in the water. And so that advanced sailing program is for people that really want to sail at the expense of some other recreation. We anticipate there will be a group who wants to do that. Yeah.
If a scout is enrolled in the Rugged S, mm-hmm. would they have the opportunity to participate in the advanced small boat sailing if they've already done the merit badge?
Do they
overlap?
Yeah, they do. I cannot guarantee that the scuba folks will have free time out of scuba during that 5th session. They are going to be scuba diving with Carter's staff. Yeah. Yeah. There potentially will be sailing opportunity for leaders and those type of scouts after dinner, but that'll be a recreation-based and kind of walk up and check in with our staff type situation. All great questions. I am going to move on to the program planner, but I can certainly answer any merit badger program questions for you as they come up. This sheet is a great adult resource, but it's also going to help the youth stay on schedule while they're out at camp. This is themed towards leaders, though. The majority of the large boxes that you see are describing either required adult activities or adult activities that we offer that aren't really highlighted anywhere else in this packet or our meeting. You'll see leader-specific assistant scoutmaster and scoutmaster training, not required, but it's an awesome, fun way to get that training done if some of your adult leaders don't have it. There's also the intro to outdoor leadership skills offered in the afternoon in our scoutcraft area. not required, but it's a great place to do it. And our Scoutcraft leadership has a great track record of working with leaders. Part of that outdoor leadership program culminates on Friday when we have a Dutch oven cook-off competition that any leaders can participate in, not just the ones in that session, but it tends to be just the ones in that session. And that Dutch oven cook-off has rules, and it's a lot of fun. It's judged by staff, and we do, this is just me attempting to say, a lot of you are going to get carried away guiding your scouts, but we do have a lot of opportunity for you when you find the time. You can check into the waterfront during Merit Badge sessions or free time sessions and ask to use equipment. If we can let you use it and it doesn't take it away from scouts, then we certainly will. But we ask that you please check in with the management in those areas before you take any of that equipment. It is our intention to provide a program for the boys first, and then allow you guys to have some recreation as well. You'll notice some mandatory meetings both on Sunday and Friday at 11 a.m. Those are mandatory for at least one leader from every troop. You've got to send somebody there for logistics, for the love of camp. You've got to come to those meetings. The leaders' coffee at 7 a.m. Tuesday and Thursday is an opportunity to give us some constructive feedback or give us good feedback. But that's when myself and the head commissioner will come down in the morning and chit-chat and take notes and see what kind of things you guys are happy about and what things you think we should look into changing. So use this to guide yourselves and make your own schedule. And the boys won't necessarily need it. They should have that youth leadership that's getting them where they need to be on time. But if you want to distribute it, that's totally fine. There's program reminders here for the scouts and also for the leaders. It also shows towards the end at 7 p.m. on 3 days a week where we keep the ranges open only for adult leaders, so you can get up there and shoot some of our firearms without the scouts trying to qualify for their merit badges. Yes?
Do you do a midweek kind of where our kids are with their merit badges?
Yeah, and unfortunately I left it off this schedule, but on Wednesday at lunch we'll have all of our directors available with their skill sheets for a one leader to check in with them on status. So we'll make sure we've got the right records and everyone's signed up for the right things, and we'll let you know if maybe a scout isn't showing up or they have disciplinary issues. That'll be Wednesday. We call it Leader's Lunch.
Along those lines, there will be three edits made to this form. We have our Buffalo Run in the morning during A session on Tuesday. That doesn't appear there right now, but it will be on the activities page on the next sheet. The Leader's Lunch for you guys to talk about all the classes that your scouts are in. And then also on Wednesday is our OA retreat. It says it's on Thursday on here, but it's actually Wednesday at 7 p.m. So the OA retreat will be for anyone in the Order of the Arrow to come in their sash, and they'll have a service project, some fellowship, and then a little treat.
Yeah, members of our staff are maturing the OA programming in camp as we speak. We've been meeting with people from the Malibu Lodge to make that happen. So we will have service projects, potentially rededication ceremony and other cool stuff. So if you are an arrowman, please bring your sash, because we'll give you an opportunity to wear it on Wednesday and have some visibility and potentially some cheerful service in camp.
What is the Buffalo Run or the SEAL?
Those are non-BSA sanctioned activities that you can earn a little patch for from camp. The Buffalo Run, you do a run early in the morning, guided by our staff one time. The Sea Lion Swim, you've got to show up three times. So it's like a polar bear plunge if you've done it at another camp, just that it's ocean themed. So you have to have some commitment and get down there and get in the water for 3 days. All right, I'm going to flip again. We're really getting there to the end, guys. I appreciate everybody's patience and involvement. I am not going to go through this line by line at all, but this is a cool cheat sheet for you. It's got a lot of weird cliff notes that I may have missed, maybe things that I touched on. But if any of these emboldened words prompt any questions, I want to give you the opportunity to ask now. we recommend maybe make a pocket size of some of these sheets or just bring a small packet. You can find the majority of this paperwork online separately from this packet, or you can print a few copies at home. We've even got a few extras sitting on the table here if you want to distribute them to some of your assistant leaders. I mentioned I did mention adult programming pretty sufficiently, but I didn't talk about War Canoe and kind of the youth leadership technique that we intend to happen at Emerald Bay. So I'm going to briefly touch on that before we close up. At camp, we have a very old program with staff members who we call Rangers. These young staff members are the SPL's best friend all week. They are the epitome of youth leadership and servant leadership. They should be. And they're the ones who are going to make sure that the troop gets signed up for the extracurriculars that we offer in camp outside of what you see on this program planner and outside of the merit badges. Things like free time mountain biking, snorkeling with your troop, playing frisbee, going on little day hikes, and whatnot. Those things will be signed up for by troop on Sunday evening when you arrive to camp. The reason I bring this up is so you can prepare your SPL to do this duty without the adult involvement if possible. We want it to be a boy run kind of thing. We want to empower that SPL. But if your SPL doesn't like to play outside, you've got to influence them before this meeting so they can sign up the rest of your troop to have fun. We have had situations where an SPL says, nobody's going to want to go on a mountain bike, which is not true. Most people want to go on a mountain bike. So talk to that boy. We have a parent and leader guide that we distributed about 2 months ago on our website. We emailed it to you, and it's still on our website. We recommend you look through that. It has a list of those activities that the SPL can sign the troop up for. So check that out and let them know that when they're in there signing up the troop, they've got to keep the whole troop in mind. Again, this is a leadership practice. They're going to meet with our staff members and they're going to sign up the entire week's worth of extracurriculars. So they've got to go in there with a good understanding of what the troop wants to get into.
Without an adult leader.
Without an adult leader, that's right. That's when the War Canoe Day will be assigned. They'll receive information about War Canoe and other troop activities that are going to be happening throughout the week. That's a meeting on Sunday night. You'll see it. Oh, yeah. Senior Patrol Leader and Ranger meeting at 7 p.m. on Sunday night. So that's one worth circling so you can prep your SPL for that.
We're coming in on that Monday, one Monday. Will any of this sort of shift?
Yes.
Or will it be exactly the same? We'll just have to dive in where we do. It's good. Monday.
We're going to still do this on this schedule, although your ranger and some camp leadership are going to be prepared to provide you with that information to make sure you're fit in. Right. Traditionally, they'll just schedule you in advance.
Yeah.
So we may reach out to you, or you'll just be doing that Saturday morning when we come into camp.
Okay.
And that's a great question. And I didn't go over on the departure sheet that we showed that for week four, we do have a Monday morning 6:30 a.m. boat. Monday morning 6:30 a.m. boat. In addition to the other boats that leave on Sunday, like every other week. So if you're coming to camp week four, you do have the freedom of choice to come on Sunday, as the traditional program entails, or to come early on Monday, as to not miss any programming and get into camp on Monday rather than Sunday. I didn't give you my little recommendation on assigning specific leaders to specific tasks because I know most troops have that down already for whatever camps they go to. But we have found that it's beneficial to assign adult leaders or parents, whoever comes to camp with you, a particular responsibility revolving around the boys for their time in camp. For example, a camp treasurer who has maybe the cash that parents have given for spending money for the boys, we recommend that there's a leader that has a sequence of Ziploc baggies with boys' names on it so they can distribute money or something like that. We also recommend some sort of medic and some sort of scheduling leader. someone who has a document that says where each boy is supposed to be at any given time, so they can help guide them into those areas. So for lack of better terms, you could have a paperwork ASM, a treasurer, a medic, and then an organizational leader or whatnot. So it might be easy for you to break up responsibility like that. It's been a successful technique that a lot of troops have done in camp. Because there are some boys, as you all know, who are going to be flying all over the place, and we need to have some leadership who have an understanding of where they're supposed to be throughout the day. Linnea, as the program director, our camp clerk, and myself will be awesome resources for you for all these logistical things that we've talked about now once you're in camp. Between now and camp, please feel free to reach out to us. We are one of the only council camps in the country that has a full-time management staff year-round. We will answer your emails. We are interested in making sure that you have the information that you need leading up to your trip. That's why we provide on this last page all of the emails and the phone numbers to reach out to whatever management person you need. If you have a question about broad programming and details on what adults can do and what youth can do, or any requirements on how to get through the program, reach out directly to Linnea. If you and myself as well. If you have issues with invoicing or actual exchange of money during or before or after camp, reach out to Kenneth, our business director. He's also the guy that runs our ship store, our trading post. So if you have questions about what we sell in that store or the way that we do business there, reach out directly to Ken. Dietary needs, we've included a Gmail for our kitchen management. You can email them directly, or you can email us and we will relay information. That is another special request form situation normally, but if you need information for very strict dietary issues, reach out directly to that Gmail. There is a caveat. Those people are cooking and cleaning most of the time, so please expect some lead time with response on that kitchen email. The majority of us, the rest of us, will try to get back to you within 48 hours of your email. Ariel, our camping registrar, is probably your number one point of contact now. She's the one who is the master of Double Knot, who can adjust your registration, help you sign up for new programs like Scuba, or change you back and forth. She works here 8:30 to 5:30, Monday through Friday, all year. So even while we're at summer camp, you can still contact her at this phone number and email right in the middle of the paper. She works full-time here in this location. And that's Ariel. She's our registrar. And she previously worked for Camp Whitsitt and has a great understanding of the registration system and all of that. Okay.
So I have one question that wasn't brought up. Camperships.
Yes. I recently approved 95% of the camperships that we've received so far, and they have been credited towards your account. If you haven't noticed, I don't know if you're the person who registered the troop, but that person should have received an email about those camperships being applied. Reach out to Ariel or myself about camperships if you haven't seen a product from those applications. There's a possibility that some of those forms are just misplaced or caught in the middle somewhere. But I did approve, for all of you who turned in camperships on time, I think that everyone should be granted at least some financial assistance. I know that we weren't able to give the exact dollar amounts that all of you requested, but we were able to help everyone who asked for help in some way.
All bad.
Yeah. I think at this point, we've already assigned over $55,000 worth of campership. So, and we still have some left. If there's people that aren't coming to camp for financial reasons, we still do have funds left. So I really appreciate you bringing that up. Wow, I think we did it. Do you guys have any other, big picture?
I earned some safe napping, real advanced safe napping.
You already have it?
I already have one. I don't have the advanced one. So it's going to, if I show up again, do I get the advanced one? My wife always.
I think advanced napping is just sleeping. Head Commissioner Rod Wheeler will be in place as he was last year, and he will be teaching the Nap Safely course that our old Head Commissioner Dave Finn created. It's an awesome patch. It's fun. Unfortunately, there is not an advanced version yet. I would have it, though. That's cool. Again, we've got packets here, and we've got packets on the internet. Let me show you folks the forms and packets page.
Which is pretty awesome.
It is by far the best resource. It's a better resource than me. I'll say it. I'm promising you. Here we go.
Yeah, this is great.
Here's CampEmeraldBay.org, the homepage. That's where you went to sign up. That's where you'll go to get any information from us. But the one page that's going to give you literally every document that you need for camp, every document that you need to fill out and turn in to us, every document with information, all of these planning stage documents that I've showed you today, they're in forms and packets. On the feature list on the left, right here, those blue titles, you click summer programs because we do run camp from March to November. Then you click forms and packets. And right here, you literally have every single form, even Carter and myself talking last year. You'll find this recording here in about a week. Every single form or information packet that we've talked about today, including all of the scuba forms, all of the medical forms, the rugged information. This one right here I mentioned about six times, the special request form right there. It's a live link. You've got camper ships and all the rest of the merit badge information right here. The packet I mentioned that has the extracurricular troop information, the things that you can do outside of badges that your SPL will sign you up for, those live in this packet right here. You should be able to click all of these and it'll open up a PDF of that specific packet or form. So forms and packets, people, forms and packets. Always don't hesitate to email us if you need help, but the forms and packets page has got it all.
What forms are expected to check with?
We've got the BSA Medical A, B, and C. We've got the consent to full program, the consent to shooting sports, which is a separate document now. National requires we fill out a separate document. There are extra copies necessary of that document. The instructions are on it. And then there is the troop manifest and personal insurance information for each participant in camp. So medical with insurance, medical with family insurance, permission form for full program, permission form for shooting sports, and troop manifest.
Are all those under one location?
They are in this spring leaders packet on the required documents page. I believe it's somewhere in the early teens in the document we distributed today. And we will email that again when we open the merit badge registration. You guys have any other big picture questions for me for the recording or for today?
Yep. Yeah, you said everyone goes on the war canoe. Is that just are we assigned before we get there and you let us know what day we do, or do we do our SPL
signs?
We'll let you know during that SPL meeting and the leader meeting, but it is predetermined by camp. And that way you can build your programs during that SPL meeting and we can assign things accordingly to when your war canoe date is. Unfortunately, we have to control that decision because the Rangers are assigned to particular troops depending on the day that they go to war canoe, and the campsites are all involved in that decision. So we will decide and let you know on Sunday when you go to war canoe. And there is a hiking option for war canoe. I don't know if I mentioned that earlier. You do not have to canoe, although 80-85% of the participants will canoe. Yeah.
We got a little hung up with merit badge registration opening time. Will you just clarify class sizes, closing down classes and everything?
Yes. So as you know, we use a digital system for our merit badges. That digital system for signing people up and putting scout information into Double Knot will be open on March 1st. You do not have to do this first thing in March. Remember, I want you to go to your troops and set up their and have individuals set up their merit badge schedules before you go into the system and sign them up. With that said, we anticipate not having to close any merit badge to any participant. That's why we have all of these recommendations and prerequisite information available to you. So whether you sign up in March or April, you should have an equal chance of getting into any merit badge, but you will need to collect that information from the scout and get signed up on your own. If you have trouble going through that process, Ariel, our registrar, is your number one resource, camping@bsa-la.org, or the phone number on the back of this packet. She can even guide you through if you're getting stuck. Now, you might not need Ariel if you're a little bit more tech savvy, because on our forms and packets page, we also have a merit badge sign-up instruction sheet. This actually has screenshots of Double Knot showing you every single step from pressing the login button to confirming the information that you've inputted. It shows it all step by step with blue lettering giving you instructions and arrows pointing to where what you need to click. So this should help you in that registration process. Again, that will be available starting March 1st up until a couple weeks before you arrive to camp. We can adjust those things in camp, but that's going to be something you've got to bring to us and ask us to do for you, because we've already produced all the skill sheets by the time you get there. Cool.
Yes, sir. I just want to say Camp Armour Bay is fantastic. The Dutch oven competition is rigged.
Well,
just so you all know.
Again, that came from my home troop. We can't let them win, obviously. But thank you very much for your input. And that prompts me for my final message, that which is, we have an incredible staff to put on this program for your troops. Although...
But they can be bought.
It is completely necessary for a successful summer camp for a volunteer adult leadership. That's why we have these meetings. That's why we want you to reach out to us directly if you have issues. Thank you all very much for the time you've already taken to set this trip up, all the time you've taken today, and all of the logistics you're still going to go through the springtime. You're not alone. We've all done this before. Email us, reach out to Ariel, myself, or Linnea. And again, thank you guys, ladies and gentlemen, for all your time already. And we look forward to having you in camp.
Good job.
Thank you.
Thank you, online viewers.